dear colleagues, dear friends, I think it is time to start with our plenary session number 3. It is an honor for me to chair this session, and it is at the same time the best moment to say thanks, many thanks, to Gabriele Cornelli for the hospitality and in general to all the staff, all the Brazilian staff, for the hospitality in this extraordinary city. Thanks for the hard work for our International Plato Society, and thanks for constructing the wonderful bridge between Pisa and Paris in the tradition of our International Plato Society. Really, many, many thanks. In this session, we have Kathryn Morgan and Edward Halper, two papers, two long papers, on the same passage of the Phaedo, that is 69 AD, 68 C, 69 D. The same passage, the same metaphor, the coinage, the currency. In the titles also, the similarity is very, very evident. We will listen to agon in the Greek, in the classical meaning, of course, a competition. And in the Greek, in the classical agon, the first speaker usually is the winner. I don't know if there are also exceptions, and I don't know if in this case the rule is confirmed or not. We will see. Of course, Kathryn Morgan is the first one, Edward Halper the second one. Kathryn Morgan is professor and the chair of classics at the University of California, Los Angeles. She received her BA degree from Brimore College and her MA and degree and PhD degree from the University of California, Berkeley. She is the author of Myth and Philosophy, From the Presocratics to Plato, Cambridge 2000, and Pindar and the Construction of Sicilian Monarchy in the 5th century BC, Oxford 2015. She edited and contributed to the collection Popular Tyranny in Classical Athens, Austin 2003. And I think it is very important to underline her activity in narratology, in relationship with the corpus of Plato, that is the myth of Plato, analyzed in a very, very important narratology perspective. We decided all together, also because the passage is the same, 69, the Phaedo, to have the questions all together at the end. Also, after listening to both the papers. Also, first Kathryn Morgan and then Edward Halper, please.
I want to start by joining in the thanks for Gabriele and his marvellous team. I will multiply them here. I also want to say, for those of you that are following along with your computer, that on Friday I engaged in some cutting, and so while the process of the topics are more or less in the same order, the talk is not going to conform precisely to what's in the program book. This paper investigates the difficult passage of Plato's Phaedo as a case study in the advantages of reading Plato with attention to his often polemical engagement with his cultural context. The coinage metaphor at Phaedo 69 has perplexed a variety of commentators. But examining briefly how Plato treats money and coinage elsewhere in the corpus, and how his usage resonates with older traditions, will clarify why the coinage metaphor was helpful. Plato was engaged in a process of cultural interrogation, I believe, which involved redefining and reissuing as philosophical a series of cultural phenomena. This is the phenomenon which Auguste Diaz called la transposition platonicienne. We shall see that the coinage metaphor makes a multifaceted contribution to the project of elaborating a system of values associated with the body. But it does more than that. It offers a way to explore the rivalry between the economic and physical order on the one hand and the ethical order on the other. Finally, it generates a set of associations rooted in the contrast between purity and impurity, associations that enable Socrates to deploy notions of religious and metaphysical sanction and reinforce the superiority of the philosophical life. Phaedo 69, A to C, comes towards the end of a sequence that's sometimes called Socrates' Defense, and I've outlined it at the first PowerPoint. This is just for general reference. Socrates is trying to show that someone who spent his life in the pursuit of philosophy should die with confidence. Starting at 64A, he mounts his case by showing that a life of philosophy is a practice for death. A philosopher focuses not on the body, which he despises as an impediment to the operation of intelligence, but on the soul. He turns away from corporeal pleasures. Only in death can he purify himself of the effects of the body and obtain phronesis. So Socrates hopes that once dead, he will attain phronesis. It would thus be ridiculous for him to fear death. That's the first sequence. At 68C5, he takes a slightly different approach, undermining the common conception of courage and moderation. People fear death, but endure it because they are afraid of greater evils. They are thus brave through fear. Men who are self-controlled resist one set of pleasures because they are afraid of being deprived of greater ones. They resist pleasure because they are conquered by it. As 69 continues, and here's the passage. I'm only going to summarize it here, not read out the translation. He uses the coinage metaphor to contrast the philosophical way of life with that of the many, still focusing on phronesis. He asserts that the right exchange for virtue is not to exchange pleasures for pleasures or pains for pains, like coins. The only correct currency is phronesis. Everything else is shadow painting. In fact, phronesis is a type of purification. Only the purified and initiated will live with the gods after death. Even this simplified summary is enough to show the complexity of the passage. Socrates uses three metaphors, coinage, painting, and initiation, in close succession. And I'm not even going to move into the slavery image here. We've had that very well discussed already. So the connection between these metaphors is not immediately evident. Understanding the coinage metaphor is then no simple matter. Julia Annus writes in a trenchant footnote, "The passage has caused much trouble, partly because of the fact that coinage serves, rather ineptly, as the metaphor both for the inferior attitude, weighing up pleasures and pains, and for the better attitude, turning to wisdom and ignoring the relevance of pleasures and pains." John Burnett thought that there could be no question of exchanging pleasures or pains for virtue, and judged that the sentence that begins at 69b1 was an interpolation. Although few have followed him, there's still discomfort at the notion that wisdom is exchanged for the virtues and that they are bought and sold with it. It's all very well to say that we cannot buy virtue by exchanging pleasures with pleasures and fears with fears, but when we come to the desirable type of purchase, there is a further difficulty in using phronesis as a currency. When we buy something with money, our stock of money is decreased. But how could we say that our stock of phronesis is decreased? So if the coin metaphor is so problematic, why did Plato use it in the first place? One possibility is that it had such advantages that Plato wanted to use it despite, or perhaps because of, its difficulties. Its rich associations offered a perfect way to juxtapose two different ethical economies, one of the body and one of the soul. Both in the Phaedo and elsewhere in the Platonic corpus, money is a key element in elaborating a value system associated with the body. Nor is the coinage metaphor the first time that money has made an appearance in Socrates' defense. The entire defense is structured by the opposition between soul and body, and between the opinions of the many and those of the philosophers. At 66, B to C, Socrates reconstructs what he imagines legitimate philosophers must think about the obstacles posed to philosophy by the body. They conclude that war and faction is caused by the body and its desires, because the body forces us to acquire kremata, money or stuff, and this entails going to war. A little later, at 68b, Socrates himself declares that someone who fears death will be a lover of the body, philosomatos, either a lover of money, philokrematos, or a lover of honour, philotimos, or both. The combination of these ideas has rightly reminded interpreters of the oligarchic and timocratic men of the Republic, as also of the discussion in that dialogue of the appetitive part of the soul as money-loving, because money is the principal means of satisfying the appetites. As Malcolm Schofield has observed in his discussion of the appetitive part of the soul, Plato was echoing elements of a long Greek reflection on, quote, greed as a prime force for destructiveness in human affairs, whether in fueling stasis within a city or empowering and then destroying imperialistic ambition, and in focusing particularly on the power of money, end quote. Schofield's analysis of the money-loving soul and of psychic tripartition in the Republic acknowledges this section of the Phaedo as an important predecessor. On Schofield's reading, money ceases to have a merely instrumental use. The desire of the appetitive part of the soul for money is naturally insatiable, both as a means and as an end in itself. It is, he argues, a way of giving effect to the insatiability of appetite. Money thus has a privileged relationship with the phenomenon of attachment to the body, so that the transactional order of the body gravitates towards expression in financial terms. It's right after the introduction of the philokrematos in the Phaedo that Socrates decides to prove that the common understanding of courage and moderation is misguided, and this is the segment that ends with the currency metaphor. Money, then, is closely connected with bodily desires, but it can also help to clarify the nature of competing psychic economies. The best example of this, and this is not on the computer, comes from Republic 4, after the introduction of the noble lie at the end of Republic 3. The auxiliaries and guardians will not possess any private property. Since they have gold and silver in their souls as a gift from the gods, they have no need of human gold. Indeed, they must not be allowed to touch gold and silver at all. To do so would be to defile their divine possession, which is pure, with ordinary currency, for whose sake many impious deeds have been done. This passage explicitly sets two different currencies in opposition. There is the currency of the many, to ton polon nomisma, and the guardian's pure coinage, and they're both psychic entities in the end. As in the Phaedo, two value systems are set in parallel and ruled in commensurate. Note that any potential intersection between the two orders is described in terms of a violation of a religious taboo, and I'm going to return to religion later. The use of the word nomisma for coinage in the Republic passage also reminds us that we are dealing with a socially embedded belief system. Nomisma can denote any custom sanctioned by usage. Why should Plato use the metaphor of coinage at all when it comes to laying out an approved system of value? Because money was, by its very nature, conceptualized as a measure of value. Even more crucial, however, is that the acquisition of excellence, arete, was already problematically ensnared in the realm of commercial exchange. Plato's sustained polemic against the sophists and their educational practices problematizes their acceptance of pay for teaching, and the troublesome relationship between money and arete comes up in a variety of contexts, such as Meno 78, this is just one example, where Socrates parodically declares that Meno has declared that arete is the acquisition of gold and silver. Or Apology 20, where Socrates narrates how he told Callias that Euanus of Paros could teach human and political excellence for the sum of 5 minas. Plato is prone to view the sophist as a kind of merchant, as he does at the beginning of the Protagoras. And in the sophist is a wage earner who only claims to deal with people for the sake of virtue. He is a kind of wholesaler for the soul. Now, the sophists aren't explicitly an issue in the Phaedo, but given the importance of the sophist as a negative paradigm in Plato's construction of intellectual activity, we can see why issues of financial exchange arose as soon as the conversation focused on the relationship between wisdom and the world. Socrates must show that admired virtues arise from the deployment of wisdom, rather than through any kind of material calculus. We would be mistaken, however, to conclude that concerns over the potential clash between arete and money were original to Plato. They were a long-standing theme in the poetic traditions inherited by him and underwent new transformations due to developments in the sphere of Athenian coinage in the late 5th and early 4th centuries. The transformations of the polis in the archaic period resulted in great strain on the language of ethical evaluation. In the poetry of the Theognidian corpus, class struggle is reflected in the pervasive language of the good and the bad. Hereditary elites clung to the vocabulary of good and noble in the face of social challenges by the newly rich. Money enables a transformation from bad social status to good social status. But it's more problematic to gain and exercise the values associated with that status. At Theognis, lines 314 to 317, for example, the poet refuses to exchange wealth for arete. Many bad men are wealthy and good men are poor. But we will not exchange wealth for excellence with these men, since the one is stable always, but different men have money at different times. In this elegiac reality, ethics, politics, fortune, and wealth have interacted to create a situation where standards of value are confused. A broad problematic is in play, one that worries over the non-congruence of the economic and ethical realms. If this is right, Plato's problems with money and the material order it represents are the direct descendants of aristocratic social and economic prejudices in the archaic period. Archaic and classical discussions of money don't stay confined to a financial context, but almost inevitably bleed over into ethical environments. The potential for a universal regime of comparative evaluation, to use the words of Richard Seaford, meant that money could have great force as an instrument of paradox, used to emphasize values to which it was properly opposed. I cite as examples two Euripidean passages focusing on arete. Euripides, fragment 542, declares, "Pale silver is not the only currency, nor is gold, but arete has been laid down as a currency, nomisma, for mortals, which we should use." Here, the two currencies are not mutually exclusive, although fragment 527 declared that money cannot buy nobility or arete. The relationship or lack of relationship of money with qualities like nobility or arete was a commonplace. It's not surprising that poets lingered on the idea of the proper role to be played by wealth in mortal life. What is suggestive is the idea of virtue itself as a currency and as an object of exchange. This is one reason why Socrates' currency analogy at Phaedo 69 would not, I think, have seemed inept to an ancient audience. It was a familiar move. To be sure, in the Phaedo, it is phronesis, that is the currency, and arete, the object of exchange. But when Socrates contrasts the opinions of the many about what can and cannot be bought with material currency, with a more refined perspective that views ethical currency as incommensurate with material goods and coinage, he is harnessing a traditional set of oppositions. Historical developments in the classical period gave a further edge to questions of acceptable currency. A decree regulating the use of coins, standards, and weights throughout the Athenian Empire has been dated at various points in the second half of the 5th century and is widely thought to have mandated the use of Athenian silver coinage as well as other Attic weights and measures within the empire. There's no general scholarly agreement concerning the impetus behind these measures. The goal may simply have been to increase trade, but there also may have been an intention to reinforce symbolically Athenian hegemony. Whatever the purpose, there is good evidence for an Athenian desire to establish a uniform system of value measurement within its sphere of influence. An interesting development in a world where multiple coinage standards coexisted. The decrees would thus offer a precedent for the quasi-hegemonic assertion of the primacy of one system of currency, owls for Athenians, map onto phronesis for the philosopher. By the end of the 5th century, the financial situation in Athens had changed due to the Peloponnesian War. In 407-6, the city issued new coinage in both gold and bronze. The gold came from melting down dedications. The latter was recalled, that is, the bronze, was recalled from circulation in the late 390s. Currency instability was problematic for a polis as proud of its currency as Athens, and fascinatingly for our purposes, was reflected in the parabasis of Aristophanes' Frogs, where the chorus draws a parallel between Athenian politics and coinage. I'm going to condense the translation here in the interests of time, and I couldn't fit the translation on the PowerPoint slide. So, the city deals with its fine upstanding citizens just as with the old coinage and the new gold. Though both of these are unalloyed, indeed considered the finest of all coins, we make no use of them. Instead, we use these crummy coppers, struck just yesterday or the day before with a stamp of the lowest quality. Just so with our citizens, the ones we acknowledge to be well-born, well-behaved, just, fine and outstanding men, we treat shabbily, while for all purposes we choose the coppers, the aliens, the redheads, bad people with bad ancestors. Even at this late hour, change your ways and once again choose the good people. As was the case with Euripides, we're dealing with juxtaposed systems of value seen through the lens of coinage. For the speaker, ethics and politics are inextricably linked. The current leaders of the city are like base bronze coinage and have displaced virtuous elites represented both by the traditional silver owls and by gold coinage. These idealized virtuous coinages were not counterfeit, but were the finest of all currencies. In this instance, then, the salvation of the city and its citizens depends on picking the correct ethical currency. The Athenians approved of this advice so much that the play was re-performed, but the city's coinage continued to face problems. In 375 to 4 BCE, Nicophon's law on silver coinage enforced acceptance of silver owls, that had been passed by a public tester. The goal of this law was to facilitate commerce and maintain the high reputation of Athenian silver coinage in the face of counterfeiting and unofficial issues. The historical circumstances that led up to the law are not entirely certain, yet it seems evident that there had been trouble among Athenian merchants, and that this trouble had something to do with the differing types of Attic owls in circulation. The 5th century decrees and the 4th century law are the products of differing situations, of course. The first is arguably imperialist, and the second economically defensive, protecting the value of Athenian currency. Taken together, however, they show that issues of currency were a long-standing preoccupation in Athens. Plato's Socrates is speaking in a world where there was not just one currency, but several. All of them could be genuine or counterfeit, and even in the case of genuine coinage, there could be questions of equivalence and exchange. Within the Athenian sphere of influence, there was ideally to be only one currency. The parabasis of the frogs shows how easily such financial matters could be transformed into ethical and political ones, especially given previous poetic traditions that had problematized the relationship between ethical and financial currency. These traditions, as well as the ongoing concerns reflected in the classical laws on coinage, created a climate that facilitated, first, consideration of coinage as the embodiment of a value system that should ideally be extensible over the widest possible area in order to perpetuate that value system. Second, consideration of multiple currencies as mutual competitors. Third, consideration of the problem of commensurability between currencies. Fourth, consideration of the problem of counterfeit currency and distinguishing it from genuine coinage. Fifth, the connection of counterfeit or debased currency with debased ethical types. All of these concerns have their part to play in our Phaedo passage. So the use of the coinage metaphor at Phaedo 69 might almost be said to be overdetermined. Traditional poetic discourse had agonized over the corrosive moral and social effects of money and had tried to upstage the monetary economy by imposing a superior moral economy on it. Plato's intellectual heritage included this discourse, and his lifetime saw complex maneuvering over the status of Athenian coinage. Plato added to this cocktail his disapproval of the sophists and a binary opposition between the material and the spiritual world. This opposition invited conceptualization in terms of colliding transactional orders. The idea that material and ethical orders might clash was by no means a Platonic invention. His devaluation of the material world did, however, make this opposition very stark. Phaedo 69 complicates the traditional picture and ties it more thoroughly to the body by speaking not so much of the exchange of money for arete as the exchange of pleasures and pains for arete as if they were coins. Paul Gooch has rightly remarked that the coins of pleasure have no real value. They are monopoly money. The issue in the Phaedo is not how the totals add up, this may well be an insoluble problem, but what sort of currency we are using. Distress at Plato's use of the coinage metaphor and for the purchase of arete is, I think, misplaced. Another advantage of connecting phronesis and coinage emerges if we return briefly to Malcolm Schofield's observation that the appetitive part of the soul in the Republic desires money both as a means and as an end in itself. Commentators on our Phaedo passage have sometimes been worried by the coinage metaphor because they conceive of coins as having only token value. Gooch seems to me to be on the right track when he observes that coins may be thought to have either intrinsic or instrumental value, and that it's a dangerous oversimplification to conclude that phronesis has only instrumental value. In a material world, then, money can be both a means and an end. In the world of the philosopher, the same is true of phronesis. The implications of nomisma as coinage go further still. It represents a socially embedded system in which people must place their trust. Silver and gold coinage was not merely token money. The metal in the coins was a commodity in itself, and in most cases, intrinsic and socially conferred value were combined. This combination of intrinsic and socially conferred value, the latter, of course, reinforced by the word nomisma, is attractive when we consider the workings of phronesis. Phronesis is both a virtue and can be used to acquire other virtues. For the purposes of the Phaedo, the notion of socially conferred value is important. It's not just a question of deploying phronesis to acquire the virtues, but of creating an entire system where wisdom is the accepted currency. Enough has been said by now, I hope, to indicate the riches of a contextualizing approach to Phaedo 69. What still remains unclear is how the currency of phronesis is connected to the images that follow. To recapitulate, Socrates says that without phronesis, the exchange of pleasures and pains is a kind of shadow painting. Moderation, justice, and courage are in fact the state of being purified from such things, and phronesis is a rite of purification. Perhaps those who set up initiatory rites were riddling long ago when they said that whoever arrives in Hades uninitiated will lie in the mud, but the one who has been purified will live with the gods. People connected with the mysteries say, many are the narthex bearers, but few are the bakoi. And Socrates thinks that the bakoi are those who have philosophized correctly. So in rapid succession, he evokes painting, purification, and mystery initiations. How do we get from the marketplace to initiation? Now, one way of dealing with this progression is to ignore it and to focus instead on the religious language. Thus, in 2006, F.C. White maintained that Socrates' defense is not one integrated piece of argumentation, but two arguments. White's analysis of the defense makes the first philosophical argument run from 64c2 to 68c4. The second, quote, largely religious, end quote, argument stretches from 68c5 to 69e2. These two arguments are, he says, mutually isolated, Socrates taking little or no account in his religious argument of points that he establishes in his philosophical argument. It's worthwhile pausing to understand the methodology that has been applied here. The commentator has drawn a line at the place where he thinks the text ceases being philosophical and starts being religious. He thinks that the religious argument is less than lucid and is there to pay off the promise to show that the dead philosopher will meet with the good gods after death. But what I find most startling about this line of argumentation is that it ignores 69a to c altogether. The examination of the currency of wisdom is not obviously connected with a religious framework. The larger question here is it legitimate to carve up the dialogue into pieces of argumentation that we take seriously and those that we dismiss? The better solution may be to embrace the thickness of Plato's narrative texture. Is it really the case that material from 68c5 onwards is separable? White thinks that this stretch of text is different from the philosophical argument in its premises and conclusion. It's also different in its religious aura, resting as it does upon religious beliefs, quoting religious sources, and arriving at a religious conclusion. Why does Plato do this? Because he was anxious to reinforce the case for saying that Socrates was not irreligious, that is, that he was pious. I want to insist that to call this whole stretch of argument religious is to misrepresent what is at stake here. Religious tropes there are, as we saw so well last night, but they're carefully integrated into an argument whose chief concern is to present a value system that competes with popular notions of what is valuable. This system establishes itself by deploying sets of overlapping cultural resonances, both economic and religious. So now, in the final part of my paper, I want to re-examine the progression of images in Phaedo's 69a to c. Let's start with calling counterfeit virtue a kind of shadow painting. The image reinforces the deceptiveness of the popular conception of virtue and may remind us of the wares of the sophist, who is compared to an illusionistic painter at Sophist 234ab. It also resonates with Republic 9, which I have for you. Socrates declares that, apart from the pleasure of a knowledgeable person, the pleasure of others is neither real nor pure. It's a kind of shadow painting. Socrates can oppose purity and shadow painting in this passage because shadow painting achieved its effects by juxtaposing patches of contrasting colours, which, looked at from a distance, gave the impression of a different colour. The Phaedo's illusory virtue that works by the calculation of pleasures and pains and uses a base currency corresponds to the impure pleasure of the Republic espoused by the lovers of honour and profit. The oppositions evoked here are overlapping. Purity versus impurity. Shadow painting and illusionistic colour versus reality. The currency of philosophy versus regular coinage. The language of purity allows Socrates to pivot the argument back into religious territory. At the end of the passage, moderation, justice, and courage are identified with catharsis, and phronesis is a katharmos, a rite of purification. Mystery scenarios of the fate of the initiated in Hades are mapped onto philosophical and non-philosophical life and death. Non-initiates will lie in the mud, initiates will live with the gods. And Socrates quotes with approval the saying, many are the narthex bearers, but few are the bakoi. But he adds in his opinion the bakoi are those who have philosophized correctly. Are we then to conclude that at this point, Socrates has left philosophical argument behind? We are not. The vocabulary of purity enters Socrates' defense early, as he establishes that the soul has the best access to truth when the body does not interfere with it. This is when it will understand most purely. At 67a5, Socrates imagines how philosophers will say to themselves that they must purify themselves from the body. At 67b2, the language becomes religious in a more robust sense, where the philosophers declare that after death, having been purified of the body, they will know truth. For it is not allowed by divine law that what is impure touch what is pure. Immediately afterwards, Socrates reinforces the lesson of the philosopher's speech by defining purification as the separation of the soul from the body, adding that this is what has been said long since in the Logos, where, no doubt intentionally, it is unclear whether the Logos is a religious account or the preceding argument. Now, White wants to cordon off the use of purification vocabulary before 68c5 on the grounds that Socrates, in fact, makes no use of religious notions in the first part of his defense. What Socrates means, he thinks, is epistemological preparation for wisdom. Yet the argumentation that follows 68c5 is economic and value-oriented and has no religious coloring at all until the end of 69b. There, the mention of shadow painting prepares us for a return to purity themes. Then the talk of phronesis as a purificatory rite marks the culmination of the language of purification that has intensified as the argument progresses. To what extent is the argument based on religious beliefs? Not very much. Although Socrates talks of initiations, underworld punishments, and heavenly rewards, he is perfectly clear that purification is equivalent to rational thought, and that the purveyors of post-mortem stories of punishment and reward were riddling. His proposal for their meaning is that the uninitiated, the impure, are those who are attached to bodily pleasures and pains, and the mud of Hades must therefore represent material contamination. Those who will live with the gods are the philosophers. The argument, I don't think, is religious. Rather, just as Socrates appropriates the language of coinage, he appropriates also the language of initiation and religious sanction to express a philosophical truth. This gives the conclusion to his defense greater rhetorical impact, but it does not alter his argumentative strategy. I've suggested that one reason Socrates' peroration ends with the language of initiation is to deploy the solemnity of supernatural sanction, or perhaps I should say metaphysical. This isn't merely a rhetorical move. The purification of the rational part of the soul was for Plato a fundamental imperative, and we've seen how various aspects of Phaedo 69 prepare us for this religious turn. Yet we can specify even further the connection between coinage and purification metaphors. It is, for example, no accident that the language of purity can also be used when evaluating gold and silver coinage and speaking of the refining of metals. Also significant was the tendency to understand the relationship between gods and mortals in terms of good and bad economic exchange relationships, although I don't have time to address this here. For Plato, the most genuinely religious purification would be the most genuinely philosophical. At Phaedo 68c5, the focus of Socrates' defense speech narrows to popular misunderstanding of Sophosthene and Andrea, and we move into the imagery of coinage, shadow painting, and purification. This passage completes Socrates' treatment of the general misprision of philosophical life by those who have not internalized philosophical values. The coinage analogy is particularly apt because the language of nomisma focuses our attention on the conventional belief systems philosophy aims to deconstruct. The reason Socrates cycles through metaphors of coinage, painting, and initiation is that they all engage with ideas of purity, genuineness, and deception. Taken as a group, they illustrate a disjunction between popular and philosophical ways of looking at value. We can only see this, however, if we take them seriously and animate them with our best sense of their contemporary resonance. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathryn Morgan. Kathryn Morgan has indicated us the organic relationship that the distinction between popular and philosophical ways of looking at virtue, at value, as in the Phaedo with the use of the coinage, with the religious perspective, with the use of coinage metaphor, of course, with the religious perspective, and in general with the memory of a popular lexicon. Very important has been, I think, the reconstruction of the historical reality on the basis of Aristophanes, Euripides, and not only. Many thanks to Kathryn Morgan, and I said at the beginning that usually the winner of an agon, of a classical agon, is the first one. That is a conscious mistake to give Kathryn Morgan enthusiasm for delivering the paper. We know that it is the second one, Edward Halper, but there are exceptions. For example, it is practically sure that an exception was in the Antiope of Euripides, in the agon between Amphione and Zeto. We will see. Edward Halper is a research professor and the main teaching professor of philosophy at the University of Georgia. He has published three books and a lot of scientific papers. Although Plato has always been of central interest, much of his work is on Aristotle, particularly on the problem of the one and the many in the metaphysics. This problem is central for the pre-Socratics, but also for Plato's later dialogues. And Edward Halper argues that the metaphysics aims centrally to address it in its various forms, and therefore that a true understanding of Plato is necessary for understanding Aristotle's metaphysics. Edward Halper has also done substantial work on medieval philosophy, modern philosophy, 19th century German philosophy. He is the past president of the Metaphysical Society of America. The title of his paper is The Currency of Virtue, Phaedo, 78C to 79D, please.
Thank you, Mauro. I'm afraid that I will fail miserably in the form of the agon, because I am not going to dispute anything in Kathryn's paper. I agree with it. It was a very good paper and very enlightening. Thank you. I'm going to take another approach to the passage that's, I think, complementary. So, sorry to disappoint you. No blood on this stage, I'm afraid.
Possibility of an agon. Just a possibility.
Yeah, okay. Well, hopefully we can work together. My passage here is, I started a little bit earlier than Kathryn, though, 68C to 69D, and it's a little strange that we have a plenary session devoted to this passage, because it seems to be a peripheral passage with no bearing on the immortality of the soul or the main themes of the dialogue. Plato is having Socrates contrast the popular notion of moderation and courage with what he calls the true, the truth about these virtues. So in the popular notion, one exchanges one fear for another. One becomes courageous because he doesn't fear death as much as he fears disgrace. One becomes moderate because he doesn't desire to indulge in physical pleasures as much as he desires to live a healthy life or something else. It's one fear that pushes out another and one desire that pushes out another. And the objection to this, the clear objection, is that one doesn't become virtuous by the opposite of virtue. You can't become courageous by fear. A person who is courageous on this popular notion is rather mastered by fear than the master of fear. The person who becomes moderate on the popular notion is mastered by desire rather than the master of desire. And after stating this, he says that the proper currency of virtue is not these fear and desire, the emotions, but rather knowledge itself. And that this is what the philosopher recognizes, and that the conclusion is that somebody who has knowledge will not fear death. So this is a little summary of the passage, which is, of course, familiar. The identification of knowledge with virtue is also familiar Platonic doctrine. Socrates argues it at length in the Protagoras, and he mentions it in the Meno. He goes on in the Meno to dispute it. But the general thought among most readers is that it is genuine Platonic doctrine. So it's plausible to find him stating very briefly in the Phaedo, a dialogue written somewhat after these dialogues, a doctrine that he had argued at some length earlier on. Nonetheless, there's a view that the identification of courage and virtue and knowledge here is not what we had earlier on. In fact, Gallup says the Phaedo endorses what the Protagoras disputes. And the idea is that since according to Gallup anyway, the Protagoras is all about hedonism, and what the Phaedo is doing is setting aside some desires here. But I think I don't think this is correct about the Protagoras. The argument in the Protagoras is that anyone who wants pleasure would have to have knowledge about which pleasures are more valuable, and therefore would have to pursue knowledge, and there's no sense in the Protagoras that knowledge would be the same as the pleasures that one would acquire through knowledge. But anyway, I'm not going to talk about the Protagoras here. What I want to begin with is this, just a part of the quotation. You have the passage. Well, you have the passage. If we can get the passage back up there, it would help. Hello. Yeah. Well, anyway, you have to memorize. Do it from memory. Anyway, here's the part of it. It's in 69b, and I'll just read it here. With this, phrenesis, we have real courage and moderation and justice, and in a word, true virtue. With wisdom, whether pleasures and fears and all such things be present or not. So it's pretty clear that the wisdom, phrenesis, is the currency of virtue. And what I want to do is, first of all, raise four questions about the passage. It'll take a little refining to get to the questions, but then I'm going to go try to proceed and answer these four questions, and hopefully they'll be resolved by the end of the paper. So the first question is this. What is it that is being exchanged for what? The passage is very ambiguous grammatically. It's now in front of you. You can see how ambiguous it is. Part of the problem here is that it begins by talking about, first of all, acquiring virtue, but then switches to this popular notion of a feeling for a feeling, a desire for a desire exchange. That's the wrong currency. And then it says we can, the proper currency, proper way to do it is to acquire all of these through knowledge. And the question is what the Panta refers to, and how it is that one could acquire desire and fear through knowledge. That's the natural way to take Panta. One could take it in a different way, but I think there's some reason to do that. But one also wonders about this. So the interpretation that's still prominent is Burnett's interpretation, which is that we use knowledge as a currency by setting aside desire and fear. If we stop having the desires and fears and use knowledge, then we can be virtuous. And how do we do that? Well, it's that desire and fear interferes with our pursuit of knowledge. So the problem with this is that there is no actual exchange involved here. In other words, Burnett is talking about an exchange metaphor, but instead of purchasing desire and fear with knowledge, we're setting aside desire and fear which interfere with our acquisition of knowledge. So there's no proper exchange. And not only that, but you could set aside desire and fear and not have knowledge. There isn't any causal connection. It's sort of like giving up chocolate in order to lose weight. Well, it might work, but then again, if you stuff yourself with pastry, it's not going to really help you. So setting aside desire and fear is not a direct path to the acquisition of knowledge. It doesn't work. The metaphor doesn't work. It makes more sense to understand the passage as an exchange of one thing for another. And the question is, what would that be? So think about the popular notion. The idea is that what you're setting aside is somehow connected with what you're acquiring. I want to get the pleasure of good health, so I will set aside the pleasure of the pastry in order for me to acquire the pleasure of good health. There's a kind of connection, a kind of causal connection there. And it isn't right. One of the reasons it isn't right, I've mentioned already, but there's another more obvious reason that it's not right. The pleasure of the pastry is a very small pleasure. And as he says here, it's an exchange, a popular conception is an exchange of a lesser pleasure for a greater pleasure. They're not equal. It's not the way financial transactions work. There's a little bit of an echo here of the form of the equal that comes later. And its absence in this particular exchange is apparent. So what we need to understand somehow is how this exchange works. And what I want to, what the grammar of the passage is, what the connection is between knowledge and fears and desires, but what I think is the problem, the refined version of the problem that I want to raise. The first problem is, if it's the case that knowledge is being exchanged for virtue, then knowledge isn't virtue. If it's the case that knowledge is virtue, they're not exchanged for each other. So the metaphor seems to fail on that basis. So that's number one. Number two, a more significant problem. The knowledge that brings virtue is, we would presume from the other dialogues, the knowledge of what virtue is. If you know what courage is, then you can't fail, and you know that courage is valuable, you can't fail to be courageous. The problem is that the preceding passage, the preceding two Stephanus pages, Socrates has been arguing that we can't have knowledge of the forms while we have a body. So the dilemma is, in order to have the knowledge that would bring us courage, we'd have to know what courage is. In order to have the knowledge that would be bring us moderation, we have to know what moderation is. We don't have the knowledge of these forms as long as we have a body. Socrates hopes that after he dies, he's going to acquire this knowledge. But it's too late. There's no point in getting knowledge of that of what courage is that will help you face death after you die. So the passage really, it doesn't make any sense as it's normally read, and I think this is a really central dilemma. There are two more problems that I want to mention before I go on. Number three is the problem that in the literature is called the problem of asceticism. And it's based on this Burnett reading, that we're going to set aside our desires and our fears and pursue knowledge. And then the idea is that virtue somehow is independent of desire and fear. Now, I don't think that this is really a problem for Plato. I mean, after all, we just had a long discussion earlier in the dialogue about the philosopher practicing death, so that he doesn't have desires and fears is not going to be a problem as far as I can see. But what is a problem here is that you don't actually set aside your desires and fears. Number one, there's the desire for knowledge that persists as long as we have a body and is actualized and taken advantage of in the dialogue. And there's the fear, the legitimate philosophical fear, that the soul will not survive death. So the problem, the refined version of problem number three is, how are we going to understand desires and fears that come, that are intellectual desires and fears, in the context of this treatment of virtue? And the fourth problem has to do with this strange conclusion that he draws, that once you understand that virtue is, that knowledge is the currency of virtue, you can stop being afraid of death and be hopeful that you will dwell with the gods. So it's not clear why it is that a purified soul would dwell with the gods or not be afraid of death. It's a leap that's not filled in here. So with these four problems, I want to suggest, first of all, that what we have here in this passage is a kind of ethical counterpart to the preceding passage. Earlier, Socrates argues that we can't have knowledge of the forms as long as we have bodies. If we can't have knowledge of the forms as long as we have bodies, and if knowledge of the forms is what's required for virtue, as he keeps saying throughout the dialogues, then we can't have virtue as long as we have bodies. So our passage, in effect, read correctly, puts virtue on all fours with knowledge. And just as we can't, as I said, can't have knowledge as long as we have bodies, knowledge of the forms, that's the knowledge that counts, we can't have virtue as long as we have bodies, because virtue requires us to have knowledge of the forms. Now, on the one hand, it seems the two are equivalent. On the other hand, they can't really be equivalent. We can get along without knowledge in our knowledge of the forms in our world. Most people do, seemingly quite happily, but we can't get along with some notion of virtue, because you have to know what virtue is in order to lead a good life. To lead your life, you have to have some conception of what virtue is. And in fact, there are numerous passages throughout the dialogue where Plato is having Socrates expound a kind of doctrine of virtue. So this is, I'm on now on page, the bottom of page five. I'm going to read the next segment here, because it refers more closely to the text. There are an astounding number of passages in the Phaedo that one way or another propound in ethics. Socrates' dream instructs him to practice and cultivate the arts. That's 60E. He claims he's wrong to commit suicide, 61C. He defends his lack of fear of death by claiming that philosophy is practice for dying and death because the philosopher despises the body and its pleasure, 64A to 65A. He derides the faint-heartedness of someone who will not examine objections thoroughly even until exhaustion. That's 85C to D. It's abundantly clear that Socrates thinks that the best way to live is to pursue knowledge. He lauds Cebes and Simmias for following out arguments and raising objections. He encourages them when the argument seems to have foundered and warns them of the dangers of misology. Socrates repeatedly exhorts his interlocutors to be courageous, and he concludes that if the soul is immortal, it requires our care in this life and the next. In short, ethical themes pervade the dialogue. These passages are generally read as part of the drama of the dialogue rather than the philosophical argumentation. I think their prominence throughout the Phaedo must signal their importance. Just what is the ethics that these passages propound? The answer is simple. Whatever else we do in life, it's essential to our embodied existence that we continue to pursue knowledge and remain confident of this path in the face of death and other obstacles. Whatever else we do, we should be pursuing knowledge. In other words, we should be doing philosophy. But in order to do philosophy, we need to overcome the obstacles to philosophy. What are the obstacles to philosophy? Desires for material things and the fear of death that leads us to do things that are not necessarily philosophical. How can we overcome these obstacles? Our passage suggests two paths, neither of which is adequate. The first path it suggests is the popular approach. Fear countered by fear. Desire countered by desire. That's not the way to overcome desires, that's a way of acting on desires. The second path it suggests is through knowledge. Knowledge, phronesis, knowledge of the forms. If you know what courage is, then you'll be courageous. If you know what moderation is, you'll be moderate. And in pursuing those, in being moderate, you will be engaged in some sort of a philosophical life. That's also not possible, at least based on what Socrates said before our passage. So we're stuck here. We need to overcome the desires and the fears, and we don't have a way to do it. We need to look someplace in the dialogue for some way, some sort of middle ground between these two excluded alternatives. So whatever the currency of virtue is, it cannot bring us genuine virtue, because that's only attainable after death. The most we can hope for is some lesser type of virtue. The Apology famously distinguishes the wisdom of the god from human wisdom. Our Phaedo passage mentions a true virtue that comes from knowledge that can only be obtained after death. Since such a virtue can do us no good, we need what we could call human virtue. And indeed, we see Plato sketching such a virtue throughout the Phaedo. This is the virtue of philosophical inquiry that I just talked about. I think that this is the virtue that Plato would have us acquire. Knowledge of the form of virtue is not the currency of virtue. It is virtue. A lesser but attainable knowledge might perhaps be used to acquire a lesser virtue. Now, at this point, I'm going to move ahead to a later part of the dialogue, which very clearly is referring to our passage. So I'm going to quote some things. If you have the paper in front of you, I'm on page 7. This is from 82 C to D is where I'm starting. I'm just going to read the quote, and it's very clear that the reference is a backwards reference to our passage. Those who practice philosophy in the, this is the quote, 82C, those who practice philosophy in the right way keep away from all bodily pleasures, master them, and do not surrender themselves to them. It's not at all for fear of wasting their substance and of poverty, which the majority and the money lovers fear, nor for fear of dishonor and ill repute, like the ambitious and the lovers of honor. They keep away from them. Those who care for their own soul and do not live for the service of their body dismiss all these things, believing nothing should be done contrary to philosophy. They turn to this and follow wherever philosophy leads them. In other words, it's the practice of philosophy that pushes away concerns for the body. It's not exchanging a larger pleasure for a smaller pleasure, or the knowledge, nor is it the knowledge of courage and moderation, the two options mentioned in our passage. These options don't keep a person away from pleasure. It's rather the care of the soul, or equivalently the pursuit of philosophy, that allows us to overcome bodily attractions. Notice the shift in perspective here in 82. before our passage, the body was providing various obstacles to the attainment of knowledge. Our passage now, or the passage at 82, focuses not on the attainment of knowledge, but the pursuit of knowledge. And the claim is just a reversal. Instead of saying the body prevents the attainment of knowledge, Socrates is now saying the pursuit of knowledge pushes away the body. That's the first transformation. The second one is even more striking. In a passage, in the passage immediately before the currency of virtue passage that I'm talking about, Socrates talked about the body as filling us with fears and desires. Now he's talking about the soul that's imprisoning itself by focusing on the body. And this is another quote, it's from 82E. Philosophy sees that the worst feature of this imprisonment, it's that it's due to desires, so that the prisoner himself is contributing to his own incarceration most of all. This is an imprisonment that's caused by the body is inescapable, but an imprisonment that's caused by the soul can be surmounted. So what do we need to surmount it? Again, Socrates goes on to explain here. It's philosophy that helps the soul see that pleasures and fears are not real. Another quote, this is 83 A to B. Philosophy persuades the soul to withdraw from the senses insofar as it's not compelled to use them and bids the soul to gather itself together, itself by itself. Very familiar language. It's form language being applied to the soul. Gather itself together, itself by itself, to trust it only itself in whatever reality existing by itself the soul understands, and to consider as true whatever it examines by other means. For this is different in different circumstances and is sensible and visible, whereas what the soul itself sees is intelligible and invisible. What's true and real is always the same. The senses are not always the same, hence they can't be real. Familiar Platonic doctrine here. Okay, but if the senses can't be real, because they're not always the same, neither can pleasures or pains. The assumption here is that if they're not real, they can't be good. Again, it's not that philosophy teaches us what is good, but that it teaches us what cannot be good, namely, whatever comes from the senses. If philosophy can't help us reach the good in this life, at least it can help us avoid what's bad. But whatever we know about them, pleasures and pains affect us powerfully and subvert our reason. Hence, Socrates counsels his interlocutors to avoid the pleasures and pains of the body, lest they be misled into thinking them real and true. So, importantly, it's the philosopher's disdain for pleasures and fears that makes her courageous and moderate. As Socrates explains, having recognized through philosophy the need to free oneself from the prison of one's own making, that is from desires and fears directed toward the bodily, the philosopher will not willingly imprison herself again by fearing to lose the body or desiring to gratify the body. It follows that philosophy prepares a person to face death without fear. That is to say, Socrates argues that philosophy makes a person courageous and moderate by stilling fears and desires. This is the final quote here. This is why genuine lovers of learning are moderate and brave. Or do you think it's the reason that the majority say they are? The majority, again, another reference to our passage, it's 83E. So what we have here is a kind of alternative account of how to be courageous and moderate. Again, there's the popular account that was dismissed. There's the account that's based on phrenesis, and phrenesis is knowing the forms. And then there's this intermediate account based not on knowledge of the forms, which we can't have according to Socrates, but rather based on the pursuit of philosophy that doesn't tell us what's really good, what is really what courage is, what moderation really is, but helps us to be courageous and moderate by focusing our attention on the pursuit of philosophy and matters of the soul. All right, So we have a third alternative that's clearly spelled out in the dialogue. It's not really discussed. Now, let's go back to our passage. It seems at first glance that this alternative is at odds with the currency of virtue passage, because according to the currency of virtue passage, you need knowledge in order to have virtue. But now we've seen, focusing on 82 to 83, that you can have a kind of virtue without knowledge, simply by pursuing philosophy and focusing your attention on the pursuit of knowledge. So at first glance, it seems as if he's surmounted the, or rejected the earlier currency of virtue analogy. But we shouldn't be too quick here. There's the question that I want to raise is, what does the philosopher know, and how does this knowledge make the philosopher virtuous? The answer to the question is not the forms. That's already been excluded right from the beginning. There's no passage in the dialogue that answers this question directly, but yet the dialogue makes the answer clear. It shows us the answer, and it even seems designed to do so. Let's notice first that the central question of the Phaedo, whether the soul is immortal, seems to be wrong-headed. Thinking about the Meno, we might wonder, why doesn't somebody say here, sorry, we can't talk about the immortality of the soul until we know what the soul is? My suggestion is that the arguments for the immortality are, in the course of making the arguments, setting out an idea of what the soul is. And the problem with the account that we get is that it's not obviously consistent. We have two different approaches to the soul. One of them makes the soul the knower of the forms, and therefore like the forms that it knows. And the other approach is the principle of life, the principle of the kind of motion that comes from life. And these two approaches are not obviously compatible. It's not clear that the soul is one. Plato is sort of adroitly deflecting our attention from the issue. But nonetheless, if I could talk about the last argument, I think it's a kind of synthesis of these two positions. But in any case, what we have on display throughout the dialogue is the soul inquiring into the immortality and, as I'm saying, the nature of the soul in the course of this inquiry. The soul inquiring into the soul. On the one hand, as an object of our knowledge, the soul is like the forms that it knows. On the other hand, the soul as the subject that's inquiring into the soul is multiple, because it's trying multiple paths to find the nature and the immortality of the soul. So what we get is a kind of reflexivity, the soul inquiring into the soul, and this reflexivity by itself shows us the difference between the soul and the body. The body doesn't inquire into its own nature, but the soul does. In the process of inquiring into itself, the soul is showing itself to be a something. It's a distinct entity from the body. It seems so obvious that it scarcely needs to be said, yet if the soul is an entity that's distinct from matter, the soul should be doing something that's distinctive to the soul. What is it should be? It should be caring for itself. How does the soul go about caring for itself? By inquiring into its own nature, by doing the very sort of thing that we see on display in the Phaedo. So as a distinct entity, the soul should be caring for itself. What does it mean? Again, the arguments for immortality aim to show the soul as something static, but the process of making those arguments, proposing counterarguments, responding to the latter, shows the soul to be actively engaged in the dynamic process of inquiry. To care for the soul is to preserve the capacity to inquire. What we see on display is Socrates and his interlocutors engaging in inquiry and thus engaging in the activity that makes the embodied soul a distinctive entity. So near the beginning of the dialogue, Socrates asks his interlocutors to grant him the existence of the forms. It's clear that they're happy to do that, but it's clear that the soul is understood in terms of its connection to the forms. It's, on the one hand, an independent entity that inquires into its own nature, but it inquires into its own nature by understanding its connection to the forms that it's inquiring into. It's a complicated relationship. But in any case, I don't want to suggest that we can't do without the forms here. What the philosopher knows is apparent throughout the Phaedo. He knows that the soul is a distinct kind of entity, distinct from the forms and distinct from matter and body. This, I suggest, is the human knowledge that is the counterpart of the human virtue that we saw on display in the previous section here. We are able to inquire because we know the nature of the soul is to inquire. And I just want to say that if this is right, then immortality of the soul is not nearly as consequential for the dialogue as has seemed. But nonetheless, recall that the sensations are not real because they're fleeting. That's one of the things he claimed earlier on. If the soul is real, as it must be if it inquires into itself, then the soul is not fleeting. If it's real and if it's not fleeting, it's immortal. So the immortality of the soul, in some sense, follows from the soul's being a something. Nonetheless, I don't think it's as important for the dialogue as some other things here. In sum, the knowledge of the soul is an intermediate knowledge of an intermediate object, an object between the forms and matter, and it produces a virtue that's intermediate between true virtue and vice. This is not the true virtue that would come from knowledge of the form of virtue, but a secondary virtue that comes from knowing the soul itself. Unconcerned, how does it work here? Because we know that the soul is a separate entity, we are unconcerned about gratifying bodily desires. It's not part of us. We're not concerned about the fear of losing the body. It's not part of us. This knowledge of the soul leads us directly to the kind of human virtue that we see on display here. All right, it only remains, I'm about to conclude here, the final section. It only remains to explain how the four questions that I raised at the beginning have been answered. The first question was how knowledge could be the currency of virtue if knowledge is virtue. I think that the metaphor is it's intended to be loose. It's intended to provoke the careful reader who is familiar with Plato's other work to say, something is not quite right here. And what we can see is that the metaphor does a kind of double duty. On the one hand, knowledge does acquire virtue. It is virtue, but that's knowledge of the forms. On the other hand, there's knowledge of the soul. Knowledge of the soul is the currency of this secondary virtue, that the virtue of philosophical inquiry that we see on display in the dialogue. So the currency virtue is a very apt virtue. But also, let's notice as well here, this has to do with the grammar of the passage. How is it that knowledge is being exchanged for desire and fear? Well, the kind of desire and fear that Plato is talking about is desire for knowledge. That's the desire that really counts. And the kind of fear that he's worried about is the fear that the argument is going to flag and we're not going to be able to continue inquiring. And that's a fear that can be stilled by the pursuit of knowledge. So I think that the grammar actually makes a lot of sense on this interpretation. The third issue that I raised was about asceticism, it's pretty clear that Socrates is not an ascetic in any way. He's encouraging a life of pleasure, but not all the pleasures. He's not the pleasures of the body. It's the pleasures of the soul that he's encouraging. And it's those are the pleasures of philosophical inquiry. So the second question that I raised was how it is that we can pursue knowledge, how it is that knowledge can be the currency of virtue that can help us face death, and when it is the case that knowledge can't be acquired until after death, according to the previous passage. And it's pretty clear how that has now been answered as well. Finally, what is it about a purified soul that makes it more likely to dwell with the gods forever? According to our passage's claim that knowledge is a currency of virtue, the soul could come to acquire knowledge. On the other hand, Socrates also speaks of the soul as having knowledge even before birth. Is the soul supposed to be intrinsically immortal, or does it have the possibility to purify itself and thereby to obtain immortality? The nature of the soul lies in its connection with the forms. The virtue of the soul lies in its inquiring into the forms. Paradoxically, Socrates separates these two, nature and virtue, when he talks about the attunement argument. Yet, when the soul ignores the body and pursues knowledge of the forms, it's engaging in an activity that fully manifests its own nature. Soul is caring for itself. Soul acts reflexively and therefore avoids the self-imprisonment that's contrary to its nature. Such a soul encounters no obstacles to its continued existence. Being purified, it harbors nothing within itself that might undermine its existence. Since it's focused on the forms, which are divine, it doesn't indeed, right? It's focused on inquiring into the forms. The forms are divine. It does indeed come to be with the gods, namely the forms. So the Phaedo then, to conclude, the Phaedo is generally read as an exposition of Platonic metaphysics. Our passage makes clear that metaphysics goes hand in hand with ethics. Insofar as knowledge is the currency of virtue, it's central to get knowledge. Hence the soul that inquires does exactly what it should do. While the Phaedo expounds a metaphysics, it displays its ethics in the actions of Socrates and the other interlocutors. Thank you.
Many thanks for the very important and interesting paper, Edward. Through the analysis of the coinage metaphor, Edward Halper has developed, I think, an important and general interpretation of the Phaedo in an ethical perspective. Also a very, very different perspective than the first one. The point is to understand, the point is to understand the relationship in the Phaedo between knowledge and the virtue, in particular courage in the face of death. The center of the argumentation has been the answer to the four questions expressed at the beginning, and the result is attention, very well indicated by Edward Halper with his last sentence. While the Phaedo expounds a metaphysics, it displays its ethics in the actions of Socrates and his interlocutors. Many thanks, Edward. So we have now time, I think 20 minutes so on, for both papers. In the last line, the first one.
Is there a microphone?
Yes, I hope.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I have a Smicron question for Professor Morgan, which I will ask later. It's really Smicronti. A Megalonti probably for Professor Halper. I think there was actually a hidden topic of your talk, and it was the passage on the genuine philosophers. So I had the impression that
the
genuine philosophers, the preceding passage on which you made many references,
yes,
during your talk, and you tried to present this coinage metaphor as a kind to solve problems that arise out of the genuine philosophers' passage. So as you pointed out, these genuine philosophers think is a kind of self-demolition of philosophy. And I wonder if you could comment on the possibility that this passage on the genuine philosophers is not at all meant seriously by Socrates. He clearly says there are some doxa I'm going to present here. And if you could comment on this hermeneutic possibility we have. Because otherwise, I'm afraid we cannot resolve the problems that arise out of this self-demolishing position.
Okay. Yes. Thank you for the question. Yes. This passage about the genuine philosophers is often read in the way that you're suggesting. I think people read it and they think he really can't be serious because what's the point of doing philosophy? And likewise, my claim that there is no genuine virtue available, even for philosophers, is likely to meet with a great deal of skepticism. So I appreciate you what you're suggesting. On the other hand, it seems to me that we have it in the text. It is it's pretty clear. It's a pretty important passage. But really, what I find interesting is that it's the 82 and 83 are really responding to this passage by offering a kind of alternative notion of virtue. And I've been arguing an alternative notion of knowledge. We can't, according to genuine philosopher's passage, we can't have knowledge of the forms, and that seems to be that's very troublesome. I appreciate that, but on the other hand, in 82 we get a kind of alternative. We can make do without the kind of knowledge of the forms that we would really want to have. We can have knowledge of the soul and recognize the soul as a kind of independent entity, and that's going to give us a kind of virtue. So if you want to throw out the genuine philosopher's passage, you're going to be stuck with dealing with 82 and 83, and I don't know what you're going to do with them. So I know that you're not convinced by what I said, because you said that we can't really deal with philosophy if we throw out the passage about if we accept the passage of genuine philosophers. So I'm proposing a way to keep the passage and understand it in a coherent, philosophically interesting way. There's something we can know, the soul. What about the forms? Well, it's not, we don't know, we don't get any definitions of the forms that really stand up in any of the dialogues. It's pretty clear that there has to be a form of justice, of courage, of moderation. There have to be forms. It's abundantly clear. But what they are never, ever becomes clear. So I think it's consistent with the dialogues to say that this passage about the genuine philosophers is legitimate. We can't really grasp them as long as we have bodies. On the other hand, we can grasp that they are. And that makes all the difference, because that means we as souls have a way of understanding our lives. Our orientation, our self-understanding is our pursuit of knowledge of the forms. So.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your paper. I have a question for Professor Halper. I accept that in our embodied existence we cannot achieve full knowledge of forms, but I think that there are many passages in the Phaedo, I don't have them available here, where it says that although we cannot achieve full knowledge of the forms, we can achieve some knowledge, or as far as possible, or as close as possible to the forms. And on the other hand, that's one of my points of disagreement, if you want. And the other is that, according to my understanding of the text, the way we can realize what our soul is precisely through achieving some contact with this unchangeable reality of the forms. Otherwise, we don't discover what our soul is, what the real nature of our soul is. Besides, I don't agree either that suppose we can achieve a knowledge and in that way to be sure about or to have access to true virtue, that that wouldn't be possible because the only thing we would know is, for example, what moderation is. I think what knowledge would provide is the precision about which desires and how we must control desires, not only a definition of moderation, but actually how to act in every occasion in a moderate way. And that would be the knowledge that would guarantee true virtue. That's my point. I don't know what you think. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So on the first point, I think I would challenge you to come up with some passages where we do get the forms. What he talks about is we know that the equals, you know, the sticks are not equal, but we know that there has to be an equal. And the equal that we somehow grasp, we want to say, okay, we sort of get it here. There has to be an equal before we can say these sticks are unequal. They're not quite the same, or they're unequal in some respect. We have to have some notion of what it is to be equal. But it's a very peculiar example, because equality is it's a relation between two things. So here we have a form that's supposed to be one. The prime example of a form that we can know in Phaedo is something that's supposed to be one, but it's a relation between two things. It's a very bad example for him to use at this point. Yeah.
It might be bad, but it's what Plato is saying. I mean, I think he's saying that we can have some access to a partial knowledge of the forms in this embodied existence. Not full knowledge, but as if you could have part of the picture, not the whole picture, as you would attain after this when you don't have the body anymore, if you have practiced philosophy, but you can access to part of the picture. I think he asserts that in the Phaedo, also in other dialogues.
I don't think we disagree about the partial character of the knowledge. It's just a question of really how partial it is. And I think my understanding makes it a little bit more partial than yours. So what I would say is that we do have a knowledge of equality, and we use this knowledge of equality when we do mathematics. It's essential to our doing mathematics. And we couldn't have a mathematics without it. So we certainly have some sense. We have some sense of moderation and some sense of courage. But they're not, when we try to think about them and understand them as they really are, we really don't get very far. And I think that's part of the point here. What we have is we know that there has to be such a thing as equality, and we can see instances of it in mathematics, and we can even see instances of it in the sticks and the stones sometimes, though they're much lesser instances. So we've got a kind of hierarchy here. Some things are more equal, some things are lesser equal. There has to be a real equal. What is it? I can't tell. And it's a very, I think it's a wonderful example to prove that we can't tell, because in order for me to understand the equal, I've got to have one thing equal to another. That's not going to be the form of equality. So I have a problem. So anyway, second point that you made. I don't think we disagree about the fact that our knowledge of the forms is essential to orient our souls, and it allows us to pursue knowledge. Our partial knowledge of the forms' existence and the necessity of their being forms allows us to orient our forms towards knowledge and do the sorts of things that all of us are doing here today. We wouldn't be here without this sense of knowledge. But even though we have some sense of it, and even though it's essential for human existence in pursued properly, as we are doing today here, it is not adequate. And that's the point. It doesn't really answer the questions about death and moderate. It doesn't tell us really what to do in particular circumstances. And that brings me to your last point. There's a kind of incommensurability here. Because what you're looking for is you want the knowledge of courage and the knowledge of moderation to tell you whether to eat the pastry in front of you. It doesn't work that way, because the knowledge is the knowledge of a form that's separate. And even though it's essential to have that knowledge of what's separate, when we actually put it into practice, what we get is what we actually see in the Phaedo and what I've been trying to set out. Maybe it's surprising, maybe you haven't heard anybody do this before, but what we get is the negative version of what you're looking for. Instead of saying, I know what it is to be moderate, and therefore I'm not going to eat the cream puff here, what we get is, there is such a thing as moderation. In order for me to be moderate, I've got to transform my soul. And transforming my soul means to focus my attention on the soul and not on the body. And I don't care about the cream puff because it's only going to interfere with my pursuit of what's really important and what's really me. So my suggestion is the way that it's actually put into practice is not the way you're suggesting, but in the negative way that we actually see at 82 and 83 and elsewhere in the dialogues. So thank you for the question.
Excuse me, it is impossible to go on Zoom because it is 1 o'clock and then we have 1 hour, less, more than 1 hour to have a lunch, and then we have the visit of Brasilia. The consequence is a very, very short question and, excuse me, very short answers. I have now, yes, and then I have, I know, and then I have, I don't know if the order is right, Professor Massey, Professor Gerson, Professor Gerson? Yes. And then Professor Robinson, Professor Trabattoni, Professor Dixo, Professor Bossi. The first one. The first one, Professor Bossi. The second one. The second one. Yes, please.
Me? Okay, thanks.
Yes.
Thanks for these papers. A very quick question of clarification for Dr. Halper. If I have philosophical virtue, do I not have any bodily desires, or do I not care about the objects of those desires, or some third alternative?
Well, you know, we're going to conclude this session so we can all eat lunch. So, I encourage you to eat lunch and enjoy it. Yes. Yeah. But you know, keep thinking about the Phaedo as you do it. Just don't focus on it. And, yeah, you're not going to get rid of your desires, but they're just not. They're not important. And if you skip lunch, okay, big deal. But that's my short answer. Yeah.
Yes. Immediately, Professor Bossi.
Thank you very, very much for both papers. I disagree with the idea that phronesis could be an end and a means. Right? Because, well, I think, could you go back to the passage, please, whoever is in charge? So I think there is a tension here between anti and meta. If we understand the tension, I think we can decipher the passage. So in my view, it is not that you give your gold your phronesis to get virtue, other virtues. You do not acquire. It's not a means to acquire other virtues in that sense. It's not that you exchange your phronesis in order to get courage. No. And according to my view, what you have here is that Panta refers to, as we said, desire, fear, and everything, that is to be if you, I think we have to separate the anti and the meta. If we separate, we understand the passage. If we don't separate, we don't understand the passage. Well, the part that in my view is easier to understand is that with phronesis, with knowledge, you get genuine virtues, which is the same story as in the symposium, right?
Right.
Same thing.
Right.
With it, you get the other, in the sense that you have to know what to fear. And if you know what to fear, you can be courageous. If you don't know what to fear, you cannot be courageous. Simple thing. Then, a moderation, same story. But the problem is with anti, because it is clear that virtue is meta phronesios. It is said somewhere else in the Phaedo. So it has to be with. And so you cannot give it. You keep it or you give it. What's on earth was going on here? So if it's anti, you give it away. And if it is meta, you have it with you, right? So that's, for me, the problem here. So if you just simply... So how can we understand the difficult part, which is the anti part? Because the other one is simple to understand in view. I think the only way is to take into account the end of the Protagoras. The Protagoras, you have the equation, virtue is knowledge. Virtue is knowledge, wisdom. Here we have a different thing. It is not exactly the same. It is metta. It is no real virtue without it, without knowledge. Right.
Okay.
But then this anti, I take it in the sense that, not that you give it away, but in the sense that you need this knowledge to measure. The most important, the Q word, the concept is measure. So as you have the metretike techne, wisdom is metretike techne, phronesis is metretike techne in the Protagoras. Here it happens the same. It is with it, having this, you can measure. So that you can measure and you can see, you can know if it is real or unreal. If it is deceit, full fear or pleasure, or it is true. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question. I appreciate the difficulty. Let me just mention about anti. Did you want to say something about this? Yeah. The anti is just a regular preposition for monetary transactions. So and Burnett takes it as instead of its ordinary sense, and then he has, you know, you get rid of the feelings, and instead you get knowledge. But it doesn't mean anything other than it's just the preposition you use when you have a monetary exchange. But notice in the first line here, he has pros. You know, you're getting, he uses a typical Plato passage, is using three different prepositions to get across the same idea. And I think that we have to understand them all as being the same somehow. Yes, and it does work. It is a problem because we are expending knowledge and we're not losing it. That's something that Kathryn mentioned, and it's a legitimate issue. It makes the image not be perfect. And my approach is, okay, so what else is new? You know, he doesn't want the image to be perfect. He wants it to be provocative. And it's more of a trouble than the currency here is we're taking knowledge and getting, taking knowledge and getting virtue from the knowledge. That, to me, that's more of a problem because he thinks virtue is knowledge.
Yes. Yes.
Right. So however we're going to cash out this preposition and the other two prepositions that seem to be equivalent, we're going to have that same problem. And I think that it's a sign to careful readers like you that something is not right with this passage, and we can't read it in the straightforward way that we would like to read it, which is, I think, the way that the second questioner was suggesting, that it was just a metaphor. Thank you.
If I could add.
Yeah.
Professor Massey?
Okay.
I have a question for Kathryn.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. Okay, so I was just going to add that I like Christopher Rowe's suggestion that the meta is added to a certain extent to transform our understanding of what's been going on, to make it clear that we then don't give away phronesis and have less of it. So, yes, I think that's right, and I think that there's a solution for the meta.
Excuse me. Thanks. Arnaud.
I have a question for Kathryn Morgan. Thank you very much for using all the context of coin exchange and Nicophon. And since you mentioned Nicophon, and we are on the anti and the pros business. The anti utei panta tota katala testa, if I get my anti right, this means that we have to have a mean to exchange the bad coins for good coins. I have to be able to exchange all my fears and desires for phronesis. That means somebody has to accept my bad coins. And would you accept then, if we go into the Nicophon decree, and the way Josh Ober has done the diagram of decision for the public tester, showing that the most intelligent thing in that decree is that you don't destroy all the bad coins, but the bad coins that are in good faith with a good amount of silver in it, you restitute to the people, and so the merchants are not obliged to take them, but they might. So that could suggest that some of our pleasures can be exchanged for virtue.
That's a great question. I don't know how I could cash it out in all its details, and in any case, the fated hour has come. But I have flirted with this idea of making ante mean something slightly different. To say that, in fact, you have to, in place of this currency, you have to use a different currency. And in that case, there would be a nice parallel with the silver coinage decree, where it's interesting, if you look at the decree, if it's base adulterated, it's struck through, you can't use it at all. If it seems to have an appropriate amount of silver in it, then acceptance can't be enforced, but it is allowed. And yeah, I think this may be a fruitful way to understand the passage.
Tom.
Thank you, Halper. Thank you, a very interesting paper. A quick question. You mentioned reflexivity, you know, as the very basis of any claim that mind and body, soul and body are distinct substances. I was just wondering, are you saying that that's actually part of the Socratic argument, or is it your gloss, that he somehow is more or less accepting that without bringing it out in any form of argument? Or are you saying that there is an argument there, the famous argument from reflexivity? Anywhere in the
future? Yeah, thank you for the question. What I'm saying is that the reflexivity is on display. So we don't have much, there's nothing explicit, but on the other hand, what we get is a constant admonition to care for your soul. So who's caring for your soul? It's the soul that's caring for the soul. He doesn't bring out the reflexivity that's involved. But it's also when the soul cares for the soul, what does it do? It engages in philosophical inquiry. And I think that's pretty clear. And when the soul engages in philosophical inquiry, what is it doing? It's trying to connect with the forms, because that's what it's, and when it's connecting with the forms, it is what it is. So yes, I mean, I take your point. My interpretation, what I've argued for here, would be on firmer ground if we could open up the book and find a nice passage where he said exactly this: the soul is reflexive and therefore it must exist. But we don't usually find passages like that in Plato. And I think what I'm relying on in my argument is when we look at 82 and 83, we find a very clear indication of a kind of virtue that's different from the virtue that we normally get in other dialogues. It's not knowledge of what the form is, it's knowledge of the soul and how the soul is different from the body. And I think we need, if we're going to take the currency of virtue passage seriously, as I think we should, then we need a knowledge that's going to be a counterpart of that virtue that's going to purchase us the virtue. And it's clear what the knowledge is. It's the knowledge of the soul that allows us to focus our attention on the care for the soul. So, I take your point. I wish it were there in black and white. It would be easy. But then again, Plato often leads us along a path and wants us to make the connection ourselves, because in making the connection, we'll be doing exactly the sort of thing that he thinks is essential to be virtuous. We'll be pursuing philosophical inquiry. And that's why, in a way, why we're all here, because these dialogues are so wonderful to think about and so provocative. So.
Lloyd Jason is not here. No, Franco.
To ask a question to Professor Mauro. I was very interested in what he said, but that passage, there is a small problem in that passage, which is that the incorrect exchange, mezzo, os elato. So is it, why it is not correct? I don't think. But I think that is a very strange expression if you think that Plato is really comparing financial or commercial transactions with the exchange between fears and pleasures and pleasures. Well, in financial and commercial transactions, you don't, I hope, you don't exchange more for less or less for more. You're supposed to respect a certain kind of equality. So what is the problem that those two words point to a kind of metric, a kind of measure that is involved, a measure which measures according more and less. That's a wrong metric. And it points to another, it calls for another kind of metric, a metric that doesn't call for more or less, but for will or schiavage. That's all I'm going to say.
No, I think I'm substantially in agreement.
The problem of measure, I think, is quite important.
I think that what is going on when we are exchanging greater for lesser is in fact not buying something. I would connect this actually more with the end of the Protagoras, as you were talking about earlier, that given a choice between a larger pile of coins and a smaller pile of coins, you will choose the larger pile of coins. It's, I think, and I think then the buying and selling gets introduced in a second stage.
The problem is not that you want to buy larger, less, smaller amount of things. The problem is how do you evaluate, how do you calculate, I can find
and
it.
And that art of measurement is phronesis.
Yes, you have to have a measure, a kind of measure.
Yes.
And, well, and that is wrong. That is what is wrong, is that you think you can evaluate in that way. So things that cannot be evaluated by that kind of metric. Thought, good, bad, or anything.
Is there time to?
If you want, but now Professor Trabattoni. after Professor Dixon, Professor Cavertoni.
Very quickly, back to what I think that there is a notion that is very useful as to clarify the passage, namely the notion of happiness, that explains, in my opinion, function, the instrumental function of phronesis, the passage, because according to Euthydemus, phronesis is useful exactly because it provides happiness in skill, the skill of the use, of the capacity of using well the goods. And I think this is not an accident, it's not the case that this instrumental use of phronesis is in this passage, because Professor Morgan rightly stressed the fact that it has happened at the hand of the defense of Socrates, and the charge against Socrates was exactly that philosophy makes an happy life, or happy only in the afterlife. And in this passage, Plato stresses that philosophical wisdom is useful, not only in the afterlife, but only to rule the common virtues, for instance. Now, and so I think that really he wanted to focus on the instrumental function of phronesis. It's not the only function of phronesis, in Plato, of course, but this passage, I think, is focused precisely on that. And I think that is helpful also to clarify a problem raised by Professor Halper, namely, you say that if knowledge is the currency through which one acquires virtue, but knowledge is not the mean in order to acquire virtue, but to acquire happiness. And knowledge and virtue are the same exactly because they are at the mean. I think that people don't need a notion of virtue different from the knowledge of what really makes men happy.
Yeah, thank you. I don't know that we disagree about this. Knowledge of the virtues is what's going to make people virtuous, and to be virtuous is to be happy. And that the problem is that we don't seem to have that. We don't have that knowledge. At least Socrates is saying he doesn't have that knowledge, so he needs a kind of substitute. And what I've been arguing here is that we get a kind of substitute. It's not ideal. I'd rather have just knowledge. And we all think we can get knowledge, but I don't know. We're here. We're still talking about this stuff 2,500 years later, and we're still debating it. And it's not quite clear that any of us have really gotten to the form of the courage, or the form of moderation, or any of the other forms. But I like your one thing that you mentioned about making the weaker argument stronger. I think it's really connected with this passage about using a little bit of desire to get something that you really desire. And there's something that doesn't fit there. And it's very, to me, it's very interesting that it's not the right kind of exchange. Nobody's going to sell you something. You buy something, you put out the money that's equal in value to what you're purchasing. And as you said, virtue, you can get it through knowledge because they're identical, somehow. Somehow.
So, many thanks, Kathryn, many thanks.